faith of a foreign woman. Chapter 9 in our study of the story, God's upper story and man's lower story. Ever been a stranger in a strange land? Ever gone someplace that you were not familiar with and you were the outsider? You don't have to go overseas as a missionary to be an outsider. But we go from one part of the country to another part of the country, and we're the strangers, we're the outsiders, we don't know anything. It's a kind of scary situation. Last week I had a young man come and he started work with us, and I have everybody introduce themselves and say a little bit about themselves. And this young man and his wife have come from New York City, lower New York City, place where Hurricane Sandy hit. He left New York City to come to Hoisington, Kansas. His mother and father had retired from their work, and they had looked, and I don't know where they live, but they had looked for places to settle and retire, and they decided to retire in Hoisington, Kansas. Now, his father has an illness of some sort, and so Matthew and his wife, who happens to be Chinese, came to Hoisington to help take care of Dad and Mom. They have a 4-year-old. They have a 4-year-old daughter, and another child is expected soon. During the course of our conversation a little bit later, I learned that he is of the Jewish faith. There is no synagogue anywhere close to Hoisington, Kansas. Wichita and Kansas City, the only places. Not only that, but they are Messianic Jews, which is really interesting. But they still practice the Jewish faith and all, and on Friday nights and Saturday is their Sabbath, and so they have devotionals and times together with the family that's there. But they're strangers. They're out of place. Can you imagine leaving New York City and everything that is there, the good and the bad, and coming to Hoisington, Kansas? How out of place can you possibly be? Unless maybe you're going from Hoisington to New York City. It's different. It's scary. The thing of it is that God has a plan. I don't know what the plan is for that young couple. I have no idea. But I know a church up there that would love to have them. Okay? Now, they would have to be willing to make some changes, but they don't have any place to worship. But I'm going to talk with him and with them. But they are strangers. In the time of the scripture that we're looking at today, it was in all likelihood the time of Gideon as judge, when a man by the name of Elimelech decides to take his family and move to a strange land. Now Elimelech, his name means my king is God, or my God is king. That's what Elimelech means. Elimelech lived in the city of Bethlehem. And there was a time of famine. And so Elimelech takes his wife and his two sons, and he moves to a different land. He leaves the land that God has given to his people, and he moves to a land called Moab. Now, Moab is a country that is constantly at war with Israel. Moab is the name of the son of one of Lot's daughters who became pregnant by their father following the destruction of
Sodom
and Gomorrah. Thank you. Interesting day today. But Moab and Israel at one time and constantly were at odds, but at this particular time there was peace between the two countries. So Elimelech goes with his two sons and his wife, and they settle in Moab. The strangers there. But they are received by the Moabites, and they remain there. And shortly after they get there, Elimelech dies. His two sons stay with his mother, with their mother, Naomi, and they marry Moabite women. And after they've been married for about 10 years, the two sons die. And Naomi, being a stranger in a strange land, decides to return to her own people. And when she decides to return, her two daughters-in-law go with her, or start to go with her. And Naomi turns to them and says, "No, you go back home. You go back to your mothers, to your family that's going to take care of you. I'm going to go back to my family, and they're going to take care of me, but you stay." Well, Orpah decides that she's going to go back in tears, but she does. But Ruth stays. And we have that very beautiful scripture where Ruth says to Naomi, and said, "Wherever you go, I will go. Wherever you stay, I will stay. Your God will be my God." A very beautiful passage of scripture. A very beautiful commitment of one daughter-in-law to her mother-in-law. And they go back. They go back to the town of Bethlehem, House of Bread. They go back to the Bethlehem. And here we have Naomi and Ruth returning to Naomi's home. Now, Ruth is the stranger. Ruth is the outsider. Ruth is from a country that is Israel's, I won't say worst enemy, but one of Israel's worst enemies. And now she's a stranger in a strange land. And what happens? Very beautiful story of how Ruth goes and cares for Naomi But I want to go back a little bit in time from where we're at right now. And I want to go back and I want to look at God's upper story for a few moments. You see, God's upper story had provided for just such a situation as this. God had spoken to his children, and he had said to his children, when you enter into the land I'm going to give you, there are going to be times when a family is going to lose their land. When the children of Israel went into the promised land, every man of all the tribes except the tribe of Levi, every man was given a portion of land. And that land was to remain within the family. If the man became a slave or became a servant to someone else and had to sell the land was eventually to return to that man's family in one way or another. It could be after during the time of the year of Jubilee, when all properties were restored to the original families. It could be another time. But if the land was taken from a family, there was one who was appointed to redeem that land. That one was supposed to take and go to the one who had bought the land or who had been given the land in security, and that individual was to buy the land back for his brother or for whatever the nearest kin was, so that that land would remain in the name of the family. He was the redeemer of the land. He was also the redeemer of the name of the family. So, whenever a man died, if he was married and he had no children, then the redeemer of the family's name had the responsibility of marrying his brother's wife, and then the first child born in that relationship was going to be the son of the brother. It wasn't going to be the man's own son, because the son would take the name of the father and would be the recipient of the land and also of the heritage of the father. So we have a redeemer of land, we have a redeemer of name, and we also have a redeemer of blood. The blood avenger. The blood avenger was the next of kin of a man who has been killed. Whether he's been killed intentionally or unintentionally, the redeemer, the blood avenger, or the avenger of blood, the redeemer of the blood, had a responsibility to kill the person who had killed the brother. And there were certain laws as to how this was to be done. Okay? If it was a deliberate act of murder, then the brother would become the prosecutor and the executioner following the law of the land. If it was an unintentional, then there would be a trial. The brother would still be a prosecutor and also an executioner if the person was found guilty. So we have in God's plan the concept, the idea that a family's name, a family's possessions, a family's blood was very important. So important that if a family was going to lose land, lose name, or lose a family member because of a murder or a homicide, then there was a way for that name to be redeemed. Now, that's God's upper plan. He's already got everything laid out in line. Now, Elimelech, when he leaves Bethlehem, he leaves his land, and he leaves the land, and his sons leave the land that they are supposed to inherit. Somebody else now has ownership of that land. So when Ruth and Naomi return to Bethlehem, Naomi has nothing. She has family, but she returns empty-handed and has nothing. She's an older lady. She can't have children anymore. And so she has no way of redeeming the land, of redeeming Elimelech's name. And so she comes back with Ruth. Now, Ruth is a Moabite. Moabites. She's an outsider. And there's a man who lives in Bethlehem who is also an outsider. His name is Boaz. Now, I say Boaz is an outsider because of the fact of who his mother was. Do you know who Boaz's mother was? Her name was Rahab. Remember Rahab? The prostitute in the land of Jericho? Who saved the two spies? So Rahab, a Canaanitess, living in the land, has been saved by God, by Joshua, as a result of her faith in God. She's been saved and she marries a man of faith, a man of Israel, and they have a son named Boaz. Now Boaz gives his father's name. Now Boaz's father is in some way related to Elimelech. I don't know how, but they're related. And so when Ruth and Naomi return, Ruth goes out to try to get money and to provide for Naomi. And she does what a lot of poor people did in those days, is that she went out to the farmland, to the pasture land, or to the farmland, where people were cutting their harvest. It was the time of the grain harvest. And so Ruth goes out, and once again, God has made this plan a long time ago, because he says when you enter into the land and you farm the land, when you harvest the crops, you leave the corners open, and then the poor people can come and they can harvest what's in the corners, and they can follow along behind the gleaners and they can pick up what's left. So God had made provision for the poor people. And so Ruth goes out and does this. And she happens to choose to go to a particular land. And she does this. Now this land belongs to Boaz. Now Boaz, being somewhat of an outsider, he's a half-breed at least, okay? Being somewhat of an outsider, sees this young girl. I don't know how old she was. She had to be in her 20s or something. She was not a young chicken or a young spry person. But she was out working. Must have been pretty good looking. Caught Boaz's eye. But to make a very long story short, Boaz treats Ruth with the utmost respect, with the utmost honor. He protects her. He says to his servants, when you are in the field, you leave part of what it is that you're doing and let Ruth have it. And he says, if Ruth needs something to drink, you let her drink from the water supply that I have provided for you. When you rest, you let her rest with the women. And men, you keep your hands off of her. Because she was open to violation. She had no one to protect her. But Boaz sees her, hears of her reputation with Naomi, and he protects her. When Ruth goes back and reports this to Naomi, Naomi, who believes that God has deserted her, okay, whose life is now bitter because of the loss of her husband and her sons, she's now poor and she has nothing in the land that she returned to. When Naomi hears the story, she says, basically, God has heard my prayer. And she says to Ruth, you go and you do what this man has told you to do. And Ruth is faithful in doing that. And Naomi recognizes that Boaz is now her redeemer. He is a next of kin to Elimelech, her husband. And Naomi knows that as the redeemer of land and redeemer of name, that her husband and her family can continue because of who Boaz is and because of what God set in place so many years before. And she says to Naomi, or she says to Ruth, you go to the field. You go to the harvest area, and after the evening is done, after all of the threshing of the grain is done, and Boaz goes to lie down in his tent and goes to sleep, or he rests, I want you to be nice and clean and all dressed up and pretty, and I want you to go to his feet. I want you to take the blanket, get under the blanket at his feet, and go to sleep. Not as bad as what it sounds, okay? And so in the middle of the night, Boaz wakes up. And he says, and he sees Ruth, and he asks her who she is, and Ruth goes through all of the story, tells him what Naomi has said, and she asks him to spread his wings over her. The request is to become my Savior. The request is to become my security. The request is to become my husband. The request is to become my Redeemer. Now Boaz has already told Ruth that God has spread his wing over her. Now Ruth is saying to Boaz, you stand with God and be my Redeemer. Boaz says, yes, I'll gladly do it. Now, he knew that he was going to have to buy the land. He knew that he was going to have a child with Ruth. And that child would be the son of Mahlon. Okay, he would carry Mahlon's name, the father's name. And also Elimelech. And he knew all of this. But he says, you know something? I am not the next of kin. There's one closer to Elimelech than what I am. And before I can redeem you, before I can marry you, before I can become your Savior, I must deal with the problem of the other man. And so Boaz goes to the city council that met in the gate, and he calls the other gentleman, whose name is not known, to a meeting of the elders at the city gate. And Boaz says to the man, Naomi has returned from her exile in Moab, and she is back with, and we need to redeem Elimelech's land. We need to redeem the land so that Naomi can have the land. Will you buy back the land from whoever it was sold to? We don't know all of that story. And the man says, yes, I will do it. You know why? More land, more riches. All right, I'll do it. Yes. There's another thing that you need to know. Boaz said, when you buy back the land, you also have to take Ruth as your wife and raise up a son to Elimelech and Mahlon. She's a Moabite. She's a foreigner. She's a stranger. She's someone that I'm not supposed to have dealings with. All these thoughts coming. And if I raise up a son to Elimelech and to Mahlon, then I'm going to have the land. I'm sorry, I can't do it. I'm willing to buy the land. I'm willing to redeem the land that way, but I'm not willing to redeem the name. You know, Ruth and Naomi's lower story and Boaz's lower story, Ruth and Naomi just had one heck of a time, strangers in a foreign land. Both of them. One in one land and one in the other land, and it just seemed like God was nowhere to be found. But then, the door opens a crack. And we recognize who Boaz is and what he can do. So Boaz has the man that is really the kinsman redeemer. He has the man to again do something that was required by law. And that was to take his sandal off and give it to Boaz. Everybody, all of the men at the city gate, all of the elders of the city, knew what had taken place. It was a completely legal transaction. As far as the law went, everything was cut and dry. Now Boaz has the right to marry Ruth, redeem not only the name, but to redeem the land. There's no redemption of blood here because there was no murders, there was no death. But we have the redeemer of blood, the kinsman redeemer, who is acting on behalf of the family. But we also have another story here. We have a story from the other viewpoint of God. God's plan was not just for the children of Israel. God's plan for the redemption of mankind was not just for the children of Israel. He used the children of Israel, but his plan was always to include the outsiders, the foreigners, the strangers. Boaz was included in the family of God because of the faith of his mother Rahab, who became a convert to the worship of God. And she had a son by the name of Boaz, who was considered to be a member, a part of the family of God. And now, this man has brought in to the family of God, of Israel, the family of Israel, a woman by the name of Ruth, who had already committed herself and her life to the family of God as a Moabite. when she committed herself to worshiping the God of Naomi. And so God takes this woman from this enemy land and brings her in and includes her in his people. And that doesn't seem like a big deal. Maybe, depending upon how you look at it. Just another outsider that's brought in and been made part of the family. And I don't know how God works or how God was working in all of this story. But in this story, God takes two women who are outsiders to his people. He takes Rahab and Ruth. And he makes them part of his people such that they are direct ancestors of his son who is going to be the kinsman redeemer of the world. Rahab was the mother of Boaz. Boaz and Ruth had a son by the name of Obed. Obed got married and had a son by the name of Jesse. And Jesse had had a son whose name was David. King David. So God in his upper story has always wanted to include in people that are called by his name, he has always wanted to include everyone, including those who are outside of our comfort zone. God chose the children of Israel to represent him and to be his people, to touch the world for him. And he showed that in his inclusion of Rahab and Ruth into his family and into the direct line of his son, Jesus, as an ancestor. We look around us today and we can see foreigners in our midst. Now, it's kind of hard to see them in St. John. But we do have foreigners in our midst in St. John. Okay? We all know who they are. Hispanics. There are some others, I'm sure, from other... Well, we can talk about Germans if we want to talk about but you understand what I'm saying, is that there's a lot of people around us in St. John that God wants to include in his family. And you and I have a responsibility of acting as Boaz did, to welcome them, to receive them, and to help them to become children of God who we worship. The story of Ruth and Boaz has many different facets. The story of Ruth and Naomi have many different sides or facets also. We're going to look at that in Sunday school. But the thing of it is that God has a plan for the world. He has a son who is the kinsman redeemer. He is the one who is the ultimate redeemer of blood. For it is his blood that was shed that redeems us from sin and from death. God said to Isaiah, I am the Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. And throughout Old Testament and New Testament, God is spoken of as the Redeemer of his people. We need to share the message of redemption to a world the story of Ruth and Naomi and Boaz. And we thank you, Lord, that we can learn from it that you are not only the Redeemer of Israel, but you are the Redeemer of all the world, of citizens from every nation, from every tribe, from every language. Father, we thank you for your redemption that has come to us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us, Lord, to be proactive in sharing your redemption with the world, as Boaz was active in redeeming Ruth and Naomi. In the name of Elimelech, help us, Father, to share your redemption with the world around us. For it's in your Son's precious name I do pray.